As Laura Spencer on the daytime soap opera General Hospital, Genie Francis went from childhood obscurity to being half of the most recognizable couple in daytime television.
It was madness, and I don't know how we survived it.
What happened with Luke and Laura was such a phenomenon.
It was everywhere. It was on the news. It was an amazing thing.
But for Genie, the show that made her a star almost destroyed her life.
It was a time of real, real desperation. I think that that's part of why I made a terrible choice.
Genie walked away from it all at the height of her fame with a secret she's held on to for 20 years.
I've never spoken to anyone about this problem with drugs, and I think because I've been deeply, deeply ashamed of it.
And when she tried to create an identity separate from Laura, Genie could not escape the role that defined her.
When you're as well known in a role as Genie is, it's impossible for people to perceive you any other way.
Yet, with the help of a new man, now 25 years after starting a cultural phenomenon as a teen, Genie has put her life and career back on track and come of age as a woman.
Genie's made a choice now to enjoy the rest of her life. The first part of her life was not all that easy.
This is Lifetime's intimate portrait of Genie Francis. Lifetime's Intimate Portrait, hosted by Meredith Vieira.
Would Laura marry Luke? We were all glued to General Hospital in the 80s, wondering about the answer to that question. And Genie Francis, who played Laura Spencer, was the young actress at the center of it all. But what we didn't know was the price Genie paid for her fame. She had to give up her adolescence, struggled with her self-esteem, and as she reveals for the first time on Intimate Portrait, had to face a drug addiction that led her to leaving the show. Watch how Genie Francis won our hearts, made TV history, but most importantly, found herself.
Where were you on November 16th and 17th of 1981? If you're like 30 million other people, you were huddled in front of a television set, anxiously awaiting the event of the year, the wedding of General Hospital's Luke and Laura.
You may kiss the bride.
In the early 80s, General Hospital viewing was a national pastime. Luke Spencer and a nation of viewers obsessed about Laura.
Their storyline was the biggest thing on television. I mean, that must have been just absurd, an absurd amount of pressure on a young person.
Almost everyone forgot that Laura was played by an innocent, impressionable teenager named Genie Francis, who had not yet experienced life.
She had her first kiss on the show before she had her first kiss in real life. She had her first child on the show before she had her first child in life. It's a very turned around way to experience your life, by first living it in fantasy and then having it come true.
Laura Spencer had stolen Genie's life. And as the line between fantasy and reality blurred, Genie learned firsthand to be careful what you wish for.
She missed out on everything, on high school, college, dating.
My life was absolutely horrible at that time. It was so lonely and so painful and so desperate.
She never imagined her childhood dreams would lead to such pain. Eugenie Ann Francis was born in Englewood, New Jersey on May 26th of 1962 with acting in her blood. Her mother, Rosemary, gave up her own career as a model and actress to raise Genie and her brothers, Ivor and Kenny, while her father, Ivor, supported himself as an actor on the New York theater scene.
My father had an extremely prestigious career, one that I envied, one that I wanted to live up to. He wanted to move into the film world and television, so he moved the family out to the West Coast when I was 6 years old.
Genie's own professional aspirations began on the stage of her California elementary school.
She wanted to perform. She had it in her to entertain, and that's what we did.
I always had a desire to not blend into the crowd. There was something about that that was very scary for me.
But by junior high school, best friends Genie and Elise were intimidated by the popular crowd.
I remember the in girls. They were just sort of like these perfect looking girls, and I still had the braces and not as nice clothes, and I didn't feel very good about myself. We were so unpopular. We were total geeks. I mean, really and truly, all we wanted to do was be by ourselves. I just remember the way I dealt with it was by taking myself out of the social arena and dreaming of the future and dreaming of being an actress.
Jeannie's dreams would soon come true.
Got my braces off, I think in the middle of the eighth grade, and as soon as those braces were off, I think I had a school picture, and I gave it to my father, and I asked him if he would have his agent send me out on some auditions.
Within a year, Genie auditioned for the popular television show Family, and the veteran actor's daughter knew just how to get the job.
They said, "Can you ride a skateboard, Genie?" I said, "Sure I can."
And I look at her, I'm like, "Genie, you so don't ride a skateboard." I mean, we were like the most unathletic people. She's all, "Well, I'm about to learn."
I played a nasty little bitch who was picking on Christy McNichol, a skateboarding bitch.
Who would have thought she was such a sneak under that little baby face?
Sneak? You know about TJ and me. What about you?
He's my boyfriend, and you know it.
Hey, relax, Alice. I just want to practice and win the contest. And $100, okay?
Well, not exactly. I want to keep TJ and win the $100. And I think I can get what I want.
Now that she was a budding TV star, the kids at school treated her differently.
I remember it very clearly, the moment I was walking down the hall in Millikan Junior High, and all of a sudden the popular girls, and boy do I remember them, turned and said, "Hi, Genie." And I thought, really? That's the first time you've said hello to me in 3 years. I didn't say that. I thought that. Initially, what I wanted was recognition and, I guess, celebrity more than acting. I really did want to be noticed.
In the fall of 1976, just 3 months after her first television appearance, all of Jeannie's dreams came true when she was cast as Laura Weber on the low-rated soap opera General Hospital. It was only her second job.
I didn't have much to do at all, maybe one or two shows a week, usually one. And I had things to say like, "Mommy, can I grow strawberries on the terrace?"
Genie was a minor player on General Hospital for 2 years as the soap struggled in the ratings. Then a new executive producer was brought in to save the failing show.
General Hospital was going off the air, and they asked me to come over and see if I couldn't raise it up in points a little bit so it doesn't go off the air in disgrace.
The first thing she did was convince Tony Geary to join her.
And I told her I don't like soap operas. And she said, "That's all right, honey, I don't like them either. We're going to change all that."
Gloria was delighted to discover the talented daughter of Ivor Francis was a member of her cast.
She took my father and me out to breakfast, and she said, "I just want you to know, Ivor, that I am planning to get the young audience, and I'm planning to use your daughter to do it."
Well, Ginny almost jumped out of the chair, and so did he. He said, by all means, we want to do it.
I remember him sitting me down on this edge of my bed and saying to me that your life is going to change now.
But nothing in Jeannie's young life had prepared her for what lay ahead. 14-year-old Genie Francis satisfied her long-held craving for recognition when she was cast as Laura Weber on the daytime soap opera General Hospital in 1976. Little did she know that the arrival of new executive producer Gloria Monty would call more attention to her than she had ever imagined.
I went from having very little to do to becoming really one of the lead characters on the show. And I loved it. I was thrilled.
Gloria Monty was determined to bring in younger viewers, and what better way than to feature the young romance between Laura Weber and law student Scotty Baldwin, the resident hunk. And at age 15, Jeannie's first on-screen kiss with actor Ken Schreiner became her first kiss in real life, and the twosome embarked on a real-life romance.
We were just young and kind of falling in love on camera and off camera, just having a fun time. It was just youth at its best.
He was the only person I had. I didn't have friends from school. I wasn't a part of a social circle.
Jeannie's heavy workload prevented her from attending school with her classmates. Instead, she studied with an on-set teacher. Hungry for friends, she clung to Ken as her peers started rushing home from school to watch Laura and Scotty's budding romance.
This was before there was MTV or any of that stuff, so that was the only thing the kids could watch, you know, was a show like this that had a real strong young girl, you know, dealing with life.
Within weeks, the ratings shot up. Genie became the focus of attention, and she knew her life would never be the same again. Her salary skyrocketed with her popularity, and she was able to help out at home.
I think I was about 15 years old when my parents asked me to assist them financially, which I was happy to do. It's a strange feeling, though, because you don't feel like a kid anymore. You feel a little bit more responsible than you ought to be. She was working with all these adults, being treated like an adult, had to act like an adult, and she was just a little kid.
On screen, the wedding of teenagers Laura and Scotty took place in September of 1979, but their happiness would be short-lived. Gloria had decided to pair Laura with Luke, an unscrupulous disco manager with mob connections.
Genie was 16 when Luke started obsessing on Laura, and I was already 33. But the connection worked better than anybody anticipated.
There was an immediate chemistry.
There's a lot right with
and it. I think it was really because of the depth that Tony brings to the simplest things and my need not to let him down.
He put the danger in her and you know, attracted her, appealed to her, the other side of Laura, the one that was not, you know, just didn't want to live happily ever after with me in a little, you know, that he was able to seduce her.
The seduction turned into a dangerous obsession, and on a desperate night that viewers will never forget, Luke took it a step too far.
I don't want to be your friend. And I can't have you. You don't belong in my world. I don't belong in yours. Look what you've done to me.
The rape scene really was only about a dance.
I said, dance with me.
The dance to that famous Herb Alpert song. And Laura screaming no. And them falling out of the shot. That's as much as the studio teachers would allow. That was it.
The storyline took a controversial turn when the married Laura not only refused to report her rapist, but found herself falling in love with him.
I think feminists were very, very upset, and I think that women who had been raped must have been absolutely horrified.
The producers never expected the couple to survive the scandal, but the audience was surprisingly accepting. The network scrambled to find a way to redeem a rapist because he and his victim had the makings of a super couple.
ABC tried desperately to backpedal, they stopped using the word rape and they started using the word seduction.
They did their best to try to clean it up. And I think they did a fairly good job, but, you know, Gloria certainly knew how to get people's attention.
That one night would forever change the lives of Luke and Laura and their portrayers. And the adventure was just beginning. Scotty soon discovered that Luke was Laura's rapist.
I, you know, went after him to kill him. And I did.
knocked him off the boat into the water and thought that he had drowned, and he didn't. That is what propelled their Luke and Laura adventures for the last 15 years. That one punch, I punched them into this hell of a story. That punch, that $1 million...
The Lifetime Intimate Portrait of Genie Francis. Genie Francis was just a teenager when fame and all of its trappings descended upon her. Cast as General Hospital's Laura at the age of 14, she shot to fame when her character fell in love with a scoundrel who raped her. By the summer of 1980, General Hospital was the number one show in daytime, and Luke and Laura were a national obsession. Laura saved her rapist from almost certain death, and the couple went on the run.
I'm not sure the young lovers on the run was done in daytime before Luke and Laura. If it was, it certainly was put on the map permanently by the story of the left-handed boy and the runaway of Luke and Laura.
That was really where it took off and went crazy. Everyone was watching it, everyone was talking about it. I don't know, we must have given people something they wanted very badly at that time.
The TV lovers created a media frenzy like daytime had never seen. Genie and Tony graced the cover of magazines from Soap Opera Digest to Newsweek. Just as Genie hit her peak, the overwhelmed teenager watched her world disintegrate. The first casualty was her education.
There wasn't enough time in the day, because I was still a minor, to get all the scenes that they wanted. So actually they convinced me to drop out of school. And I did it.
There would be no high school diploma for Genie, whose last school-based friendship fell by the wayside.
We were leading two completely different lives. I was dealing with little high school problems, and she was a little girl thrown into this adult world and trying to deal with all these adult problems.
To make matters worse, her family was having a hard time adjusting to her sudden fame.
Here's your little family of five. What do you do when the middle teenage child becomes a phenomenon? How do we handle this as a family? You know, there aren't many books out on that. And it does rock the family.
And while Jeannie's father was more comfortable with her success than the rest of her family, Genie was troubled.
I had a great deal of guilt, because there I was working and getting all of this attention. And my father, who was really the actor in the family and far more deserving of all of that than me, that was really hard for me.
Genie chose this difficult time to assert her independence and moved from her parents' home into her own apartment.
So I thought, well, if I get my own apartment, then I, you know, that'll be a step towards being more adult. And I took that step. I really wasn't ready at all.
I kept on saying, the kid is young, and she's had so much success, landed, and she's been lauded, so she doesn't realize what she's doing.
A breakup with her boyfriend deepened Jeannie's despair. When the focus of the show shifted from Scotty and Laura to Luke and Laura, Ken left both General Hospital and his girlfriend behind in the summer of 1980.
If we had stayed together, I might have been okay through that period of time. That might have been the thing that carried me through. You know, but there was nothing. There was nobody.
The world knew nothing of Jeannie's inner turmoil. Her adoring fans were enchanted by Laura's TV life.
We had people screaming like we were the Beatles or something.
It was madness. I don't know how we survived it, truthfully. We survived it by going back to work and keeping our mind on what we were doing, or trying to keep what was left of our minds.
The frenzy peaked on November 16th of 1981, as across the nation, students cut classes, their parents took the day off from work, and people huddled around televisions to attend the wedding of General Hospital's Luke and Laura.
Lucas Lorenzo Spencer, king of the single life, is giving it up today!
When Genie Francis was 19, 30 million people tuned in to watch her second TV wedding, a ceremony that remains the most viewed moment in daytime television.
I, Lucas Lorenzo Spencer, take thee, Laura Weber Baldwin, for better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer. In sickness and in health. Until death do us part.
And Gloria Monty had some surprises up her sleeve. Elizabeth Taylor had requested an invitation to the festivities, and the role of Helena Cassadine was created especially for her.
My curse on you, Laura and Luke.
And perhaps the biggest shock was who returned after a 2-year absence to catch the bridal bouquet.
It was kind of the height of the hype. All this bizarre stuff was happening, which really was out of our control and out of our scope.
Beneath the glamour was a lonely child struggling to be accepted in a grown-up world.
I knew that I couldn't quite fit in with the adult people on the show unless I seemed more like an adult. And I really wanted to fit in with them because they were kind of my last hope.
Isolated from her family and friends, the needy teenager found her place among the in-crowd by pretending she was a drug user.
They included me in it. And I knew the first time I took a hit of cocaine that I had a problem. It was obvious to me because that took away the pain inside. The pain was numbed. And all I knew was, wow, I got to get more of this.
I was in my mid-30s. How Genie did it at teenage and early 20s, I just don't know.
It's all about wanting to fit in at that age. It's all about that. And it was the reason that I did it. I was afraid to do it. I made myself do it. And I, within, you know, an hour, had a problem. A serious problem.
Both Tony and Genie were in trouble.
It almost broke me. I did not fare well for 2 or 3 years. I was doing a lot of drinking and a lot of escaping into drugs and other respites.
I wish I had known more. I really and truly do, because I would have taken her and Tony and said, come on, this has got to stop, or let's do something about it.
It was really a pretty intense situation. I'm very lucky that I'm alive today.
Most devastating to Genie was that her addiction was ignored at work.
There were people who knew that there was a problem going on and didn't do anything, covered it up.
In the fall of 1981, after 5 years on the show that made her a household name, Genie's fairy tale life finally fell apart.
I made the decision to leave the show in one morning, one awful, awful morning. At this point, I think I had been having the problem with drugs and alcohol for about a year. And I had been out and partying for a long period of time, for maybe, I don't know, maybe it was 48 hours or something like that. And I think that I passed out in my house. And my brother came and found me. And I remember at some point looking up at him and saying, take me to the hospital. I need help. I had a sprained ankle, which they bandaged. I had a burnt hand because I guess I had set my finger on fire.
Unbelievably, despite her overnight hospital stay, Genie was expected on set the next morning.
I'm not really sure who came to get me from the hospital, but I was taken from the hospital in my bandages and whatnot to General Hospital and to my dressing room. And they put me in my dressing room, and they had makeup and hair come to my dressing room and make me up in there so that nobody would see the state that I was in.
In Jeannie's battered condition, a knock on her dressing room door from a meddling associate would end it all.
They said that it didn't matter if you lived or died because Tony Geary is the whole show. And I left the show in that heartbeat.
That was it.
ABC went crazy, the whole thing, and I said, well, she wants to go, she must have to go.
I knew that I was never going to get clean and off the drugs and sober as long as I was on that show, because now I had associations with the show and all the places in the building and the drug itself, because it was everywhere.
In January of 1982, Laura Spencer disappeared into the fog, and unbeknownst to her legions of fans, Genie began the battle of her life. She would suffer the consequences for years to come.
I think leaving General Hospital at the peak of my popularity virtually stopped my career.
Over the course of 5 years on General Hospital, Genie Francis became one of daytime TV's biggest stars. But the pressures of being a teenager in an adult world took their toll. In December of 1981, an addiction to cocaine forced her to leave the show at the height of her popularity.
You know, my mission at that time was to get clean and sober, and that is what I began to do. But unfortunately, what I also began to do was overeat, because it's very common to switch addictions.
Overweight and still in recovery, 19-year-old Genie was handed the lead in the miniseries Bare Essence, starring Linda Evans, Donna Mills, and Jonathan Frakes.
She was this young, vivacious, funny, talented girl who I used to sit and schmooze with in the makeup chair.
What I liked about Jonathan right away is that he was not at all impressed with who I was right from the get-go.
The other actors weren't quite sure what to expect from their famous co-star.
The character that she played in Bare Essence was a much more sophisticated kind of character than she played on the soap opera. And I think that I kind of wanted to wait and see whether she could pull it off.
In the miniseries, Tiger Hayes enters the world of fashion and fragrance when she loses her beloved father.
What I'm wondering, when are you going to cut the bull? For you, Jack was 15 years and 3 marriages ago. Now, that hardly qualifies you for the role of the grieving widow in the $2,000 silk dress.
The miniseries was so popular that it was reworked into a weekly series in 1982, but it lost its luster and was canceled mid-season. And by 1983, almost 2 years after her departure from General Hospital, Genie had conquered her addiction, lost her excess weight, but couldn't find work.
When you're as well known in a role as I am, or as Genie is, or as many other of my colleagues are, it's impossible for people to perceive you any other way.
Tony was also ready to leave the Luke and Laura phenomena behind. Genie agreed to a limited return to give the devoted General Hospital fans some closure.
When he was ready to go, they wanted to bring me back so they could send us both off into the sunset.
Luke and Laura reunited as Tony and Genie left the show together in 1984. Soon after, Genie accepted a role in the epic miniseries North and South. As fate would have it, her friend Jonathan Frakes was part of the cast that headed for Charleston, South Carolina for a marathon shoot.
We were there for 12 months. We did 12. It was, took longer to shoot than it did the Civil War.
The time was well spent.
I saw Jonathan again, and I just fell in love. It was like, it was almost like we'd never seen each other before. It was very strange.
I mean, I didn't schedule my classes in college around Luke and Laura, which I think has been a blessing in many ways and has allowed me to fall in love with Genie instead of with Laura.
And I remember the first moment that, you know, I put my hand in his, and I knew that I was going to stay there.
What I felt for Genie was as much love as I knew I could feel.
The couple returned to Los Angeles and became engaged in 1986, but their happiness was shattered when Genie's father succumbed to a series of illnesses. With Ivor's death in October of that year, Genie had lost her biggest supporter.
I always felt that my father really accepted me fully and completely and loved me fully and completely. And it was a huge, huge loss.
The effect of Ivor's death lingers, obviously. Genie was the success that Ivor wanted to be. But Ivor was distinctly proud of who she became as a person and as an actress.
Genie mourned Ivor the only way she knew how, by returning to work. Although she had reservations about daytime, another soap opera wanted Genie Francis. And since no one else was knocking down her door, she became Diana Colville on Days of Our Lives in 1987.
I missed acting, but I knew I had made a mistake. I knew it was a step backwards. And I was very, very disappointed after I did it.
It was impossible to recreate the magic of Laura. But Jeannie's husband was having better luck with his own career. As Commander William Riker on the hit series Star Trek: The Next Generation, Jonathan joined Genie in popular culture. The two television icons solidified their union with their marriage on May 28th of 1988.
My brother said, as he proposed the toast at our wedding, and here's to Genie, the most beautiful of all the brides she's ever been.
Happily married and financially secure, Genie decided to leave Days of Our Lives. But her new husband was working long hours, and the lights of Broadway beckoned Genie.
I would never be a real actor until I had done something on the stage in New York, because that was who my father was, and until I did that, you know, that was a personal dream of mine that I just had to fulfill.
And ABC helped make that happen by offering her a job on All My Children in New York.
In 1990, Genie reluctantly left her supportive husband in L.A. while she settled into the role of incest survivor Sarah Connor on All My Children. In her spare time, she performed on the stage. Her outstanding portrayal of a child in Defying Gravity at the Williamstown Theater Festival led to her off-Broadway debut as a poverty-stricken mother pregnant with her fifth child in The Baby Dance.
The most challenging role I think I've ever been given, ever.
I saw the play 7 times. And each time I saw it, I got, God, if people knew how good this girl was and didn't just think of her as Laura.
Ivor's memory comforted his daughter on opening night.
My father had this little lucky horse that he kept in his makeup box all his career. And I taped it to my belly underneath the baby. And I took my dad up there with me.
Next on Intimate Portrait, Laura gets Genie fired.
I was worth more money to the network playing Laura and doing Luke and Laura than I was doing Sarah.
By age 29, Genie Francis had lived a life that few could imagine. During the 1980s, her portrayal of General Hospital's Laura Spencer had turned her into an overnight sensation. But Genie sacrificed her childhood and her sobriety in the process of becoming a star. With the encouragement of her husband, Jonathan Frakes, Genie was back on track by 1991. She'd achieved her dream of performing on the New York stage and had a fulfilling role starring as Sarah on the soap opera All My Children.
Those 2 years in my life were the creative high of my entire career.
But despite all her efforts to leave it behind, General Hospital was about to intrude into Genie's life once again. Tony Geary had returned to the show in 1991 and was playing Luke's look-alike cousin, Bill Eckert.
The audience didn't want to see Bill Eckert. If I was going to be on General Hospital, they wanted Luke Spencer. So they talked to me about doing Luke, and I said, I can't do Luke without Laura.
And the network agreed, so strongly that Genie was fired from her job on All My Children.
Because I was worth more money to the network playing Laura and doing Luke and Laura than I was doing Sarah. So, unfortunately, I lost that job.
Well, the network didn't give her a choice. You're not going to be playing Sarah on All My Children, but we would love you to come back and play Laura on General Hospital.
I remember the night that I said yes. I cried all night. I really believe that that would be the end of my career.
It was both strangely comforting and sad at the same time. You know, I walked through the doors and this wonderful guard said to me, Miss Francis, welcome home to your General Hospital family.
Genie returned to both of her husbands in Los Angeles and was pleasantly surprised to find that things at ABC had changed drastically over the years.
Well, that's the circle. That's the completion of the circle. Now, all of a sudden, this place that was the source and the home of such incredible pain and agony and depression and volatility and confusion is now the place that she goes where she has family.
Luke and Laura returned with their 11-year-old son, Lucky, played by Jonathan Jackson. Genie was determined to spare Jonathan the torment she'd gone through as a child star.
There was an instant connection of like a mom and a son.
I wanted to give to him everything that I wish had been given to me.
And she was very concerned with what I was going through on the set, and just very protective and did everything to make sure that I was feeling comfortable and safe.
The only positive thing that you can do with the negative things that happened in your own childhood is try to help somebody else not make the same mistakes.
Genie was disheartened when her TV son decided to leave the show in 1999 in search of a film career, but did some of her best work during the storyline revolving around his departure.
I need to see him.
I want to see my baby one more time.
Please.
That's all right. Detective, I've got you, baby.
Jonathan Jackson's influence on Genie had been even more profound.
Having him in my life and playing his mother, it showed me this other part of me that I didn't realize was so fun and so fulfilling. And, it really made me realize that, you know, I'm ready for this. I am ready to be a mother.
As her life had paralleled Laura's so many times before, Genie went from being a TV mom to a real-life mother to Jameson Ivor Frakes and Elizabeth Frances Frakes.
For the first time in my life, there was a little bit of balance. It wasn't just Genie the actress, Laura and the career. There was a real other personal life that was very important that was starting to happen for me.
She has a schedule where she works part of a day and they shoot her scenes in a lump. She works, whatever, 2-3 days a week.
And I think she probably sees the value in a normal childhood, you know, which she didn't have, which I'm sure that she'd like to give her children.
They know to keep her there, that the kids come first, and they've got to make that work.
Jeannie's 13-year marriage to Jonathan is going strong, but sadly, her TV marriage hasn't fared as well. Luke and Laura were recently divorced, just shy of their 20th anniversary.
They will always be connected, but it felt like the termination of that whole chapter since the wedding.
Not many people experience what we went through. You know, that kind of strange, overnight, hysterical popularity.
In a way, it's like, you know, guys who've been in war together.
Of course, the sacrifices that Genie made for Luke and Laura still linger.
I've never spoken to anyone about this problem with drugs, but... And I think because I've been deeply, deeply ashamed of it. Because I'm basically a good girl, you know, and I think that that's why it's important, to say, you know, what makes a good girl make that bad choice?
I hope that today, if someone was in that kind of condition, they would be taken care of instead of forced to go on.
As far as I know, they do have programs at ABC now, and at many places where if an employee shows signs of having a drug or alcohol problem, they do intervene, and you don't lose your job. You get sent somewhere, and you get help.
On General Hospital, Laura is currently dating her first husband, Scotty, and Genie is on familiar ground, now happy in both her on-screen and off-screen lives.
I think she has come to terms with the fact that she really loves her life. She loves her family, her kids, her life here. She loves it.
This is not the little girl I started working with. This is a woman, a formidable woman, with an extraordinary intellect, great humor, and I think her work has just begun.
It has been a remarkable journey. I think as I get older, I have more and more forgiveness for myself and more acceptance of myself and the mistakes that I've made.
After all she's been through, Genie has realized that fame and fortune don't compare to the simple pleasures of home and family.
And Genie's made a choice now to enjoy it the rest of her life. The first part of her life was not all that easy.
I've gone through a lot of struggles in my life, but my family and my husband, you know, that's what it's about for me now. It's my children and my husband, you know. That's the dream, and I got it.
Hard to believe that Genie originally stepped onto the set of General Hospital as Laura 25 years ago. And this month marks the 20th anniversary of that most famous daytime TV wedding, the wedding of Luke and Laura. Tune into General Hospital this month for a little nostalgia. Whatever happens, we'll be sure to watch what Genie does next. For Lifetime's Intimate Portrait, I'm Meredith Vieira.
Hi, I'm Genie Francis. I know how hard it is to make the first step towards recovery when you're drug or alcohol dependent, but I also know how great it feels to live free of addiction. If you're having a hard time making that first step, or you know someone else who is, please call the Center for Substance Abuse Treatment at 1-800-662-HELP or go to LifetimeTV.com. It's our lifetime commitment to you.